Forget frequently asked questions.
Common sense.
Common knowledge.
Or Google.
How about advice from a real genius? 95% of people in any profession are good enough to be qualified and licensed. 5%
go above and beyond.
They become very good at what they do. But only
0.1%.
are real geniuses. Richard Jacobs has made it his life's mission to find them for you. He hunts down and interviews geniuses in every field. Sleep science, cancer, stem cells, ketogenic diets, and more. Here come the geniuses. This is the Finding Genius Podcast
with Richard Jacobs.
Hello, this is Richard Jacobs with the Finding Genius Podcast. My guest today is Andrea Ferrero. He's an associate professor in the Department of Economics at University of Oxford. He's also a Levine Fellow in Economics at Trinity College in Oxford. He teaches undergraduate and graduate macroeconomics. And I wanted to talk to him because, the situation with government-imposed shutdowns, economically, I don't know what's going to happen. So I wanted to ask and see if, someone like him that's in the economic world has insights on what he thinks is going to happen from here onwards. So. Andrea, thanks for coming.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
If you want just a quick background, what got you into studying economics in the first place?
Yeah, well, it was quite incidental. I was I'm from Italy. In Italy, you don't study typical economics in high school, and so my choice to embark in my degree was a little bit by exclusion. I knew that there were certain things that I didn't want to study. And so economics and management, which was my degree, was kind of attractive, perhaps because I didn't know much about it. But I went in thinking I would do management. And I think after maybe a semester or two, I realized that I actually did not like management at all. And so again, the choice of going into economics was kind of, more of a negative one. And also when I started doing more economics, I never thought I would become an academic. I thought, maybe I would work in finance or consulting or something like that. And it was only towards the end when, first of all, in part, I took more advanced courses, but also I started doing a little research because in Italy you have to do a thesis for your undergrad. I got really excited about a more academic approach to some of the questions that I was looking into, and so I decided to pursue a graduate career.
And what's your research been about?
So I work on several topics, but all are sort of related to macroeconomics and monetary policy. I started off more on the international side. So I was looking out of graduate school at the U.S. current account deficit and what were the main determinants. So I graduated in 2006. That was a big debate at the time. And then later on, I started working on, topics related to financial crisis. My first job was with the Federal Reserve in New York. And so it was an obvious choice. I mean, it was basically starting in 2007, but especially after 2008, it was what we were talking about every day. So then since then I kept a little bit of both interests, like some topics that I work on are more on the international side, some others are more on the monetary policy and macro side.
What's it been like for you the past 3 or 4 months during the coronavirus pandemic shutdowns? It must be very interesting, intellectually.
Well, it's interesting to read the news and try to make sense of the current situation, but it's also extremely boring because I haven't left my house, I guess, like many people. Jokes aside, I think this crisis is very different from the other type of crisis that we've seen and studied you know, in the past, I guess, with the 2008 crisis that started in the US and then became global, but also with the European debt crisis a couple of years later, you know, we focus a lot on the financial system and on the implications for the real economy. Whereas this one, you know, is a crisis that, you know, although some people have mentioned before that could, you know, we could be in a pandemic situation, we weren't really thinking so much about. And so there's a whole new set of questions that we're facing, both as, you know, as economists and as policymakers. And so, you know, it is quite interesting, but, you know, it's also, I guess, very, very challenging.
Well, what are some of the important trends or, you know, waves or activity that's going on that you've noticed? Where do you think we're headed over the next six months worldwide?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess a big difference compared to the financial crisis of 2008 and 2010, 2011 in Europe is that pretty much everywhere, I would say, governments have been, you know, extremely aggressive with fiscal policy. I think this reflects two main reasons. One is that monetary policy didn't have a lot of room to respond to the current situation. You know, interest rates were low everywhere. The few countries that had a little bit of room to cut interest rates did cut right away. So, like, you know, the US, but some other countries like in Europe, the ECB didn't have any room to cut interest rates. So, I mean, central banks did other things, other type of intervention. But the room for an aggressive monetary policy response was somewhat limited. And so then fiscal policy became the obvious instrument to respond to the crisis. You could also argue that, you know, this is a little bit more controversial. It's not quite clear whether, you know, what the right response to this kind of episode is, because it has features both of a supply shock, because some sectors completely shut down, but also of a demand shock, because, you know, people lost their jobs, and so they lost their income. And so it's the objective, I guess, of both monetary and fiscal policy to provide support to people and business situation. So I think overall, this suggests that the policy response is extremely challenging. I think this is one of the main topics that are currently on the table for debate pretty much everywhere in the world. Where are we heading? I think, you know, it's anybody's guess. It's, I think, you know, a lot of will depend on how the health situation will look like over the next, you know, couple of months, and whether there's going to be a second wave. So that's obviously one factor is going to be. There's been a lot of discussion about the kind of recovery that we may see. I was just looking today at the expectations that members of the Federal Reserve have. Of the FOMC for the recovery. So they're seeing, you know, a deep recession this year, followed by, you know, a quite strong rebound next year, and also, you know, somewhat more moderate, but still solid for 2022, I guess. So I guess that's a baseline scenario that many people have in mind. But again, I think that a lot is going to be depending on what's going to happen in the next few months between now and, say, the end of the year. If we have a second wave, will that mean that we'll have a second round of lockdowns? You know, will there be a vaccine in a reasonable amount of time, and so on? So I think all this, I guess maybe the bottom line is that there's still a lot of uncertainty around, and we see this also through the response of financial markets that are, you know, still quite volatile. Some days are responding to a few good news, but some other days are worried about second waves and further lockdown.
So what interesting market behavior are you seeing? You know, now you could say you have some experience with an economy like this, at least for a few months. So What are some things that happened that totally surprised you, or something maybe that didn't surprise you but were important?
I mean, I don't know if this was anything completely surprising. You know, again, because this is a new type of episodes, I wasn't sure exactly what to expect to some extent. But perhaps, you know, I was a bit surprised maybe that the rebound in the stock market was as fast as it has been. You know, market actually took relatively, you know, few weeks to go back to the point it was before the news of the epidemic spread around. You know, I was expecting a rebound for sure. And I was expecting the rebound to take place well before the real economy would recover. But at the same time, you know, I was surprised that it happened so fast. Again, you know, because of the uncertainty still around, maybe it's too early to assume that the rebound will you know will last, and maybe there will be further losses down the road. I also try, you know, this is just more of a personal preference to take a little bit more of a longer run approach and avoid being, you know, affected too much by the day by day fluctuation in financial market. So, you know, I take these movements a little bit with a grain of salt. I mean, the other feature, but it's not so much related to this crisis, that is notable in financial markets is that long-term interest rates are historical lows. And, you know, there was discussion before the epidemic started that was going on basically since the financial crisis, shortly after the financial crisis about whether we were going to live in a world of permanently lower in long-run interest rates. And I think this crisis just reinforced that view that low interest rates are here to stay for, you know, quite a long time.
You think low interest rates or negative interest rates? Or, I mean, what has that experience been like watching, you know, at least in banks, negative interest rates being offered to customers and customers maybe reacting in a different way than expected?
Yeah, I don't know. I think the evidence is still not completely clear on the effect of negative interest rates. I mean, my impression is that negative interest rates are not as disruptive as some people had suggested they may be, but it's also not quite clear to which extent they have the same effect and the same power that interest rate cuts have, you know, in positive territory. So I think that's a little bit of an open question. I mean, there is some evidence that there is pass-through of negative interest rates one way or another, meaning that, you know, if you are a corporation, you're going to face negative interest rate. If you are an individual, you may not face negative interest rate, but you may get higher fees on your account or, you know, something like of that sort that basically is an effective negative rate. So that's on the one hand suggests that bank profitability may not be hurt as much as some critics of negative rates are suggesting. At the same time, you know, there is going to be some level, you know, whether it's zero or below, where, you know, the zero, what we thought was zero, the lower bound is going to kick in, right? Because central banks cannot go as negative as they can expecting to keep effects from further cuts.
Wouldn't it discourage saving, discourage keeping any money in the bank, encourage people to keep savings in cash because of the negative rates?
Yeah, no, that's exactly right. I mean, that's the you know, so-called liquidity trap. You know, when further cuts in interest rates are not going to be effective because people would rather keep cash under their proverbial mattress. So the point is that, you know, if you are a corporation that saves sums in the order of millions of dollars, you know, it's going to take a while before you take all your cash out of the bank, but at some point you will, right? And so that's why I guess negative interest rates may have some effect, but not in full.
Why do banks do that? Why do they have to go to, why don't just stay to zero? Why negative?
Well, because they think that negative, that zero is not low enough, that they would like to cut interest rates even further. So if the economy is really doing poorly, you would like to cut interest rates. And at some point when you hit zero, if the economy is still doing poorly, you would like to cut below zero. So that's the rationale. The question is whether it works or not. Now, central banks have used other ways of responding to this type of situations. So they've done a lot of QE. They've used communication about their intentions for the future, trying to affect expectations. And then, of course, fiscal policy now being used, was saying before, quite extensively. This current crisis as well.
So do you see any activity building? Do you see, people not going out, accumulating a lot more in savings? And if so, will that cause a pent-up demand that will all of a sudden be spent in a large amount? Like what dynamics are happening right now, do you think?
Yeah, so I mean, that's all a little bit anecdotal because, we don't have data yet, not even of this quarter, just the one where we'll see. So this quarter, I guess we'll see the big effect of the big negative effect of the pandemic. And then before seeing anything to restart, we'll need to wait even a little bit more. I mean, we've seen some strong rebound in expenditure in the US. And there is quite a bit of evidence that, again, a bit anecdotal, but that people are really eager to go out and sort of make up at least in part the lost time. I guess the holiday season is also one where people are encouraged to spend a bit more. At the same time, we need to balance this with the fact that there are several people who've lost their jobs, and so their spending capacity may not be as strong as it would have been otherwise. One thing that I thought is likely to happen is, purchases of durable goods, for example. If you were planning to buy a car, right, or if you were planning to buy a new house, for example, those must have been postponed for sure. And so if you still have the spending capacity, there's likely to be a rebound in the next few months, assuming that the health.
Yeah, maybe that's a better way to put it. So if assuming there is no second wave,
yeah,
what do things look like in a few months? And assuming there is a second wave, then what do they look like? What are your scenarios?
So, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think this is really, very contingent on the developments in the health situation. I think, again, if there is no second wave and the situation stabilizes progressively, as we've seen happening in most countries, then I think there could be a strong rebound. I'm fairly confident about that. I would say that, a lot of people lost their jobs, may be able to find a new, hopefully. And so it's likely to be a strong recovery by the end. If instead we see a second wave, then it could be really tricky. Partly because, there's been quite a huge effort in terms of fiscal support to avoid the worst consequences for both families and businesses. And it's not clear that countries will have the same fiscal capacity to support a deep second wave. So I guess the intensity of the second wave is going to matter a lot. But if we see something like we've seen this spring, again in October, November, December next year, it's unclear to me that government able to go out and provide the same kind of. So I think that that's kind of the bad scenario that we're facing. And again, depending on how you place your probabilities on those two is going to inform your views and going forward.
Yeah, do you think governments have capacity to withstand more lockdowns do you think people do? Or do you think the economic pressure is so great that people are just going to have to learn to live with, you know, the coronavirus and have the economies open?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, so it's, I think it's a very tough question. So, you know, instinctively, I would say the main concern that most people have is their health. And so, you know, you would expect to see a response that is cautious if the health situation does not improve significantly. I would, you know, I'd be very worried about going out and, you know, risk getting infected if there is a second wave. But I think, you know, it's not so easy. I mean, we've seen many instances in which people seem somewhat defiant to this type of view, and so it's unclear how the pressure comes from the different groups in the population are going to affect political decisions in terms of the response to potential. So I don't honestly know. I mean, this doesn't necessarily have to do a lot with economics. It has to do more with health policy and the political process. I mean,
economics is a big factor. If you can't
eat,
you know.
No, absolutely. But what I'm saying is that, you know, I guess there is one dimension in which if we can fix the health, if we can control the epidemic, right? If we have the appropriate ICU capacity, if we have the resources to deal with the epidemic, then, you know, as a byproduct, we're also able to mitigate the effects on the economy. The big problem occurs when you're facing the trade-off between, you know, saving lives and tanking the economy, which I guess is what you're alluding. But I think you really want to, you know, build that capacity when you have the opportunity. So I think that would be my instinctive reaction to this, to the current situation. Use the time that we have now to make sure that if second wave hits, we are prepared this time.
Do you think any nations are taking it that way and listening, or are they just maybe too scared? They're just caught in the day-to-day and that's all they can think about?
Yeah, I'm a little worried about that. I'm a little worried that the day-to-day crisis management is taking the eyes away from the longer-term objective, which is to be able to face, you know, a similar crisis, to learn from the current, from the past wave, the one in this spring, and to be able to cope with potentially. So I'm a little worried about that.
Very good. Andrea, what's the best way for people to find out more about your work? And any ideas on what they should keep tabs on economically to keep their hand on the pulse of the economy?
Well, I think we're going to get some data, some more data soon coming out. And I think that will give us a good sense of, you know, how the labor market is responding. You know, we've seen a good labor market report last month, so hopefully the good news will continue. So my hope is that, you know, the data will support a little bit of optimism going forward. And obviously on the health side, that the measures that have been put in place will be enough to avoid a second wave. But it's really that interaction, that interaction between the health scenarios and how the economy is going to be crucial, you know, for the next 6 months or so, until we get a cure and we don't have to worry about virus.
Very good, Andrea. Thanks for coming.
Well, thank you very much.
Perspective.
Thanks a lot for having me.
Excellent.
If you like this podcast, please click the link in the description to subscribe and review us on iTunes.
You've been listening to the Finding Genius Podcast with Richard Jacobs. If you like what you hear, be sure to review and subscribe to the Finding Genius podcast on iTunes or wherever you listen to podcasts. And want to be smarter than everybody else? Become a premium member at FindingGeniusPodcast.com. This podcast is for information only. No advice of any kind is being given. Any action you take or don't take as a result of listening is your sole responsibility. Consult professionals when advice is needed.